Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the afternoon session. I hope no one is feeling very sleepy after the lunch break, screen break. So this afternoon, we have a session on education in the times of the new normal with specific focus on girl child. So we have Seda Milgram Imam, former executive creative director, J. Walter Thompson, for Central Asia, member, National Commission for Minorities, Government of India, as a keynote speaker for us. And standing first class first in Bombay University, as Seda Ma'am was appointed Fellow of English Literature at the then Ivy League Elphinstone College, Bombay, where she taught her subject. To pursue writing as a career, she joined advertising and retired as Executive Creative Director of India's largest advertising agency, J. Walter Thompson, directing campaigns in all countries of South Asia. Indeed, she helped them build their second agency, Contract Advertising, one of the country's most awarded agency in her time. Mrs. Imam has been juror on many international creative awards and herself won many, including the Super Achiever Award by the Change Management Institute, Pune. Government of India then persuaded Seda to join as member of National Commission for Minorities, and thereafter for another 3 years, the Ministry of External Affairs as member, Haj Committee of India, Committee of India. She remained a communication consultant given her unusually varied experience. She has authored various books, and she's also founder director of Rumi Foundation and consulting editor of Who the Sufi Way. So welcome, ma'am, for the afternoon session on education in the times of new normal with special focus on girl child. As moderator for the session, we have Dr. Maithili Hazarika. Welcome, ma'am. She is presently working as Associate Professor of Clinical Psychology, Guwahati Medical College, Assam. Dr. Hazarika is an Associate Professor of Clinical Psychology, Guwahati Medical College, and in Guwahati Medical College Hospital, Guwahati in Assam, and has been in the Department of Psychiatry from the last two decades. She's the president of SOMHIL, a Society of Mental Health in Lower and Middle Income Countries, and has been active in community mental health programs. Currently, she is in India lead of a UK-India Right Three project on reducing the neglected burden of multimorbidity in children with the disorders of intellectual development in Northeast India. So we would like to give a warm welcome to Dr. Maithili. So thank you, ma'am, for accepting the invitation to be the moderator of the sessions. And for the speakers, the presenters of the various research paper that has been shortlisted for the session, we have Sumana Sarkar, Principal Sachideva Global School, Delhi, speaking on analysis of the impact of COVID-19 online education on the three learning domains of students. We have Seema Gupta, Coordinator Satyabharati Adasini Secondary School, Jhaneri, Punjab, talking on education in the time of new normal. On online education, a tool or barrier for the girl child is going to be presented by Asta Dingra, TGT, Teacher Development Coordinator, TDC, and Director of Education, Delhi. And we have the fourth paper on online education, again, a tool or a barrier for the girl child, with Pal Singh, head teacher, Satyabharati School, Barikas, Uttar Pradesh. So warm welcome to all the speakers, keynote address, the guest of the session and the moderator. Before we start, and I hand over to Seda Ma'am for her thoughts, I would like to launch a poll. I hope all of you are able to see the poll now. We have 337 attendees, and including the panelists, we have 365 people on Zoom platform. Request all of you to take part in this poll and choose one of the options that you like most. We have another 30 seconds before I close the poll. Request all the participants to take part in this poll. Good. We have almost 42% already completed the polling. Request the remaining 60%. Maybe the lunch is becoming an issue, I guess. After lunch, no, just like any class, after lunch is always a difficult session. So I think the guest of honor for the day and the moderator has going to have a tough time. So all the best to them. Let's see whether we can wake up with the participants a bit more. 54% I have given, very good. I will keep the poll open for another 20 seconds. While growing up, what did you like the most is the question. The first one, music, dance, playing or sports in general, cinema. So please click one of the options. So another 10 seconds. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and I'm closing it. We've got more than 60% of participating. I'm sharing the results. I hope all of you are able to see the results that has been polled. So the highest is for playing. 54% have given the answer as playing is something which you really liked most while growing up, followed very close by 33% music, 9% dance. Cinema was liked only by 5%. So that's the polling result for before we start the session. So we have now very close to 400 participants for the information of all the attendees and speakers. Once again, welcome to all of you. I'm stopping to share the results. Once again, welcome to all of you. Over to you, Sida ma'am, for your opening remarks.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay. You know, I have never accepted a request to speak, to give a keynote address or whatever it is, as readily as I have accepted this one. And I think it's got a very simple reason for it. The simple reason being that if I have done anything reasonable, useful, important in my life, it's because of some fantastic teachers I've had. And no other reason, really, because, and as you probably remember what has been read out in my thing, I went to teach myself and I realized that I'm nothing like them. I'm nothing as good as them. And one very important thing you realize, it's one of the most critical professions in the world, because it is about making people what they are. It's making people different to what they could be if they left themselves alone and so on. So it is such a major, major advent in somebody's life to change their lives. And nobody quite recognizes it. It's not supported by the government. It's not given the importance by whether parent or any authority at all. And basically what one realizes is that it is not information. Why it's so important, it's not just information of, you didn't know something, I'm telling you, now you're informed, I'm your teacher. No, I think teaching, and particularly today with the computer having taken over, the telephone having taken over, every other gadget in your life having taken over, right from the age of 5 or 6 or 4, information is coming to you. My daughters and granddaughters will tell me, I know everything that you're talking about, because they've already seen it, right? So teaching is far, far beyond that. And whoever's involved with teaching here knows that. Important thing is that does one realize what is the key thing that you need to do, which is not so, it's not rocket science, is actually what is a beautiful little frontispiece, you know, what comes in front of a novel, just a few lines from the author. And I remember reading this in A.M. Forster's a novel called Morris. It says, only connect. Only connect. And that is exactly what a parent must do to its child. Most importantly, what a teacher must do to its student. If you don't connect, if you don't make that interesting information, it is not going to be imparted. And in any event, he's going to read it in a book or on the computer screen or on his telephone screen. So the point is that you have to animate the idea. You have to connect with the person. And how much teachers are doing it today, I honestly don't know whether they can, especially now with this COVID situation. We are doing it in a certain atmosphere and with a certain number of gadgets and a certain number of limited time, all of those things you are dealing with or the teachers are dealing with. We are just worrying about it. But I think it's important to worry about it. And it's important for all of us to see how can we suggest something or do something to make it a lot better. And then, of course, we come to the question of the world, what's going to happen to the girl child? See, one of the other things you taught in communication, which is where I went from teaching to learn in advertising and communication, was that unless you get a response to what you're saying, you haven't actually communicated. You haven't really done anything if you merely said what you had to say. You know, when a parent scolds a child, this child is rejected what the parent is saying. I mean, he's shouted, he's screamed, he's repeated himself, but he's not communicated. So that particular aspect is very, very important, right? So here we are faced with a problem, actually. The problem really is that the child is at home. Now we are focusing in this session on the girl child. She's at home. The parents are saying, good, she's at home. She can do a whole lot of work. So we are worried about the fact that she's not going to be doing schoolwork. She's not going to be informed or imparted any education. She'll probably be married off. And so or the usual syndrome that happens to a girl child will happen to this girl child. So the problem is more acute. Now, in communication, you are actually taught that a problem is actually an opportunity. And I'm trying to suggest to all the listeners that each one of us consider this problem as an opportunity. And my suggestion to you is that straight away, or before we do anything else about starting home education through the machine, we should actually have a long session with the parents. See, giving the person importance of a certain kind, with a certain regard, and that you are critical in my work, you will get, only you can help. And they are the guardians. They are the people who are looking after those kids. So my thing to you is that have a very, very warm and respectful and esteemed sort of session with them, where you really are able to say that, look, without your help, we can't actually do this. And in order to do that, and do it together, I would say both of them together. And I would say to you also that say to them that with a girl child, this is a fantastic new happening accidentally. She is now going to get a dual qualification. You are at home with her. We are able to give you 2 hours in the morning and hopefully a little bit more connection through the day, which we can talk about a little later. But we are giving you her to be with you and be at home from 8:30 a.m. or 9 a.m. for the rest of the day, and she's yours. You are going to make her obviously work at home. Nothing wrong with that. Let us not make a parent feel guilt for making the kid work at home. It's their child. It's their child's free time. Every time she helps them, she's qualifying herself for life. To say, and to be honest with you, if she works through the day a little bit in the house and then does her homework and is able to revert the next morning, personally, every child in the whole world actually is doing it. You kids dream about going to America to study. Every kid has to do everything himself or herself. There's nobody to do anything for her. Not only that, there's nobody to take her to the doctor. Nobody to take her if she needs anybody. She is totally on her own. So to say that this poor little Indian girl, she's got to do this and she's got to do that, that's life. You are in the comfort of your home. Your mother is doing most of the work. She's asking you to do a few things. And those few things that she's asking you to do are going to stand you in very good stead through your life. Whether you're studying abroad, you're studying in India, you're getting married, and you're with very, very critical in-laws. in any event, it's teaching you to be independent. So it's a dual qualification. The great thing that has happened in this terrible, terrible COVID-19 situation is your child is at home. It is protected. It doesn't have to use transport, expose itself to obviously various hazards which people in various parts of India have to go through to even reach school. She's being spared that. Not that there's anything wrong with it, but she's being spared that accidentally. She's all there for you. You can train her. This girl is going to be doubly, triply qualified for marriage or career or whatever. So there's nothing the matter with it. So remove this thing of what a dire strait and how tragic that the child is being made to work doom. In fact, if you're talking about women's violence against women domestically, which is supposed to be a great problem of this darned COVID-19, rather more exaggerated because of COVID-19, if you make your father the hottest chapatis, the way he likes them, if you make the brothers and whoever is mistreating you his favorite chutney, I don't think they're going to beat you up or bully you or whatever it is that they do. All I'm saying is there is an opportunity in every problem. And I think that when you're talking to the parents, tell them about this so that they grasp the good things they can do with the kid at home rather than say, feel guilty or do more of it. You know, it's basically, I think, important. I think I've made the point strongly enough. I want to move on to something else, which you may tell me is not possible. I'm saying when teachers are actually communicating now at this remote level, is it possible for them to use the girls' names when they speak? In other words, they're giving a class, a lecture, and they're saying, have you understood? Meghna, I hope you've understood because I would like to have feedback to say you have. If there is a possibility of the students communicating their responses, reactions to the teacher, if you, let's say you address one boy's name and three girls' names, give the girls a feeling, and so as to figure out whether they are actually listening to you or not, or feel rotten if they had disappeared somewhere. So in other words, Anjali, have you understood? Anjali, I want a tick from you saying you've got the message. I don't know. I'm saying use these techniques in order to also make everybody in the class feel that, you know, Anjali, Prema, Meghna are as important as Sunil and Anil and whoever else. So patently, I'm saying, can we also suggest that in the evening, is it possible? These are mad thoughts, crazy. I'm a creative person, don't forget it. So I will give crazy thoughts. You have an evening session where just an hour when you get a feedback from the kids about what they went through. Have they understood what happened in the 2 hours in the morning? Can they be given a little quiz? Can they be given some fun things to answer, respond to, and so on? And which is why I wanted to check on what makes people all very excited and involved. Cricket may be the thing, since sports sort of scored so high, I would say use the cricket medium to connect with them, or a music, because music plays in their ears and haunts them and so on, so that the connection between the teacher and that information she's giving and the student is magical, emotional, and much beyond the facts. And they won't forget it. And what I'm trying to say is that I think the most important thing to me in terms of why I think I gained from my professors is that they enjoyed themselves while they were teaching. I don't know whether good or bad or whatever, but they were enjoying themselves so much that so was I. Because if they were declaiming and saying, this is what Shakespeare said and this is what Chaucer said, so I'd make notes, right? The way they were doing it was something which made me feel this information is my information, actually. Yes. I was, in fact, saying to somebody that they would not complete their sentences because they wanted you to complete their sentence for them. So you need, when you talk to your students and so on, you need that participation from them to say, kabhi samajh mein to aa gaya, kali maine bakh diya aur aapne sun liya, ye nahi hai. आपने सुना, आपने समझा और आपने अपना लिया उसको. You know, so in that exactly in the end is communication. So I think it's an important thing for you to realize the effect you're having on children. I was reading a poem which has won many awards from a student to a teacher. It's an ode to a teacher. And if you give me time, I'll read it out. If there's no time, I'll stop. But let me just open that.
I think we will go through the video if you are ready for it.
Oh, you want to go on to the video, right?
No, I think with that one, and we can come back for the poem because.
Oh, all right. Lovely, lovely, lovely. Whatever you suggest, I'm at your mercy. It's a poem, it's an ode to a teacher, which I will read if I have the time. Okay. Otherwise, I'm through.
Yeah.
And you can start.
Sridha ma'am has, you know, I'm sure some of you would have already seen this video. It's just a 2 minutes video. It's a good message for this new normal times. Can we have the video, please?
मगर वक्त ही तो है, गुजर जाएगा, गुजर जाएगा। जिंदा रहने का ये जो जज्बा है, फिर उभर आएगा, गुजर जाएगा, गुजर जाएगा। माना मौत चेहरा बदल कर आई है, माना मौत चेहरा बदल कर आई है, माना रात काली है, भयावह है, गहराई है, लोग दरवाजों पे रस्तों पे रुके बैठे हैं, लोग दरवाजों पे रस्तों पे रुके बैठे हैं, कई घबराए हैं, सहमे हैं, छिपे बैठे हैं, मगर यकीन रख ये बस लम्हा है, दो पल में बिखर जाएगा, जिंदा रहने का ये जो जज्बा है फिर असर लाएगा, मुश्किल बहुत है मगर वक्त ही तो है, गुजर जाएगा, गुजर जाएगा। बाजार खाली, सड़कें सूनी, मोहल्ले वीरान हैं, बाजार खाली, सड़कें सूनी, मोहल्ले वीरान हैं, खौफ बरपा है, हर तरफ लोग हैरान हैं, ये वो कहर है जो दुनिया को डराने आया, ये वो कहर है जो दुनिया को डराने आया, मगर ना समझ है जो इंसान को हराने आया, इतिहास गवाह है ये मसला भी सुलझ जाएगा, इतिहास गवाह है ये मसला भी सुलझ जाएगा, जिंदा रहने का ये जो जज्बा है गुम हुआ है टूटा नहीं, जिंदा रहने का ये जो जज्बा है गुम हुआ है टूटा नहीं, यही जज्बा फिर असर लाएगा, फिर उभर आएगा, मुश्किल बहुत है मगर वक्त ही तो है, गुजर जाएगा, गुजर जाएगा, गुजर जाएगा।
सो थैंक यू मैम फॉर योर मैसेजेस एंड नो द वे यू हैव टॉक्ड फ्रॉम द हार्ट and bringing teacher as a focus, and the teacher can make your life and make it also not just life, make it also an enjoyable life, and that's one of the key message which I liked in the whole focus, apart from various other points that you have stressed. We will definitely come back to the ode to the teacher, that the poem that you have got it. So I think we have now 473 participants who have logged in, and over Facebook Live we have got I think almost 200 or plus participants as well. So we've got a good participation for this session. So I would like to invite Dr. Maithili to take over as a moderator and continue the session.
Yeah, thank you. A very good afternoon to one and all. And it's a pleasure to be here. And the keynote speaker, Mrs. Saida Bilrami Imam, was wonderful in talking about the attachment, the connection, and a lot of things about self-sufficiency as well as being self-reliant. And I think this is a great message for everybody, how we can fuse the work and our day-to-day activities together and lead a balanced life from the very initial days of our life. Thank you, ma'am, for enriching me as well as others here. And it's a pleasure and a delight, and it's a privilege for me to be here. Thank the organizers to have invited me here as a moderator. And what we have understood is that since so many months, we've been passing through various kind of crises. The crisis is economically, it is huge. And I think that is spilling over into different dimensions, like the social, health, as well as the educational dimensions at this point of time. And so we consider this phase as a new normal, as everybody is calling it to be. And now today, to focus on the new normal in a girl child is something very crucial. We understand the lacunae and a lot of deficits that our girl children faces in every domain, not only in education. And you know, because of that, the liberalization, the various concepts have come up, and also feminism and so many other stuff. But when the COVID had started in Assam, I am from Guwahati, as you all know, I'm from Guwahati Medical College. And being in the domain of mental health, we were at a loss, like we didn't know what to do with our patients and how to connect, as connection is always important. And when we lost the connection, the face-to-face connection, then over here, the government had taken an initiative for the COVID-19 patients. So I just wanted to give a short, if people can share my presentation, I think it's given there, or I can also share it. If Anthony, you can help me out. So basically what happened was in Assam, we had an initiative called Monon. I'm just giving a health perspective that is going to definitely spill over the educational perspective. It is like, what happened, the second slide, please. We had wanted to know about the psychosocial concerns in different group of population. So what happened was there were around, because we were very less here, like very handful of psychologists. As you know, in India, the mental health domain is underrepresented because the gap is very high between the treatment team and the need of the population. So we had to train a lot of people from the master's degree level, and because trained counselors were lacking, we had made some guidelines, and from the guidelines, we had trained a lot of people. And 324 active counselors were there, and a lot of people had come in later on, and we became 418 people. And the government had given around 90,744 data till today, and we could counsel around 40,194 people who had COVID-19. And then we had to see the psychosocial concerns, the second slide, the next slide, please. So then what happened was we saw that among these people whom we had counseled, there were around 735 children and adolescents. And they were from different districts of Assam. In Assam, there are around 31 districts. And from there, most of the people from the children are from urban areas, like Guwahati is the state capital, and Dibrugarh and all these semi-urban places. And most of the population, the children were from these kind of areas. And there were other rural population also. Next slide, please. Then what we thought was like how to counsel them. So we had actually counseled the children via individual counseling. We had started counseling these people via telephone, that is 104, as well as our private lines. And there were people who were like in the quarantine centers, the children were in quarantine centers, but with the children, the parents were also there. It's not that they were left alone, the younger ones. So there were around 57% who were females and 43% males. And next slide, please. So what we found was that the educational area also, the kind of education they had also varied. There were people, there were very, 50% of them were up to 12 standard. And it was like a varied population according to the ages, because a lot of people were very young and they have not started education yet. Next. And the occupation, what we saw was there were definitely manual and skilled workers because of the rural poverty and other unemployment issues in the parents. And 91% were students in this population. Next slide, please. And next slide, you can go to the next slide. Then physical illnesses were there in this population. Around 6% of these children had physical illness history, like respiratory illnesses, diarrhea and anemia and all those issues. And all these were actually collected. When we were doing counseling, we used to ask the questions to these children. And we found out that there was history of certain physical illnesses in these children. But it's not that because of that they got COVID, but we had taken the history while taking and we had noted them down in the portal that we had created. Next slide, please. Then in the psychiatric illnesses, what we found was around less than 1% had psychiatric problems like inattention, hyperactivity, and autism and other stuff. But again, this was very less, and we had done telephonic counseling. We need more data to know whether they could fit into a disorder kind of a criteria. Next slide, please. What we found was the symptoms related to COVID in these children in Assam was around 31% had symptoms related to COVID, and around 68% had symptoms which were asymptomatic COVID patients. So they were tested because the parents were symptomatic and probably the children also got symptoms. Next slide, please. Then what we found was, as we know from the United Nations, that the infection with the virus itself is huge, and the immediate socioeconomic impact is also huge, as well as the potential long-term effects. And these are the three main channels through which children are affected by the crisis. And it is seen in our population. Next slide, please. What we found was, like, it is very interesting, you know, across the genders, if we can see the special concerns. So you can see the special concerns in males. It was financial assistance was a concern in the male population, and as well as the parents of the male people, we had inquired about it. And there was family stressors, which were seen more and reported more by the girl child. So that was another thing. And social rejection was also felt by the children. I mean to say, in and around their places, they were rejected, and the stress related to COVID was also very high among the girl population. So it was like a mixed kind of a concern. And we also know that with extreme deprivation of this kind, acute stress can also impair the cognitive development. And if this cognitive development persists, then it will definitely have an impact on the learning mechanisms, because if attention is distorted, we are fatigued, and COVID is impacting our health in this way, then definitely in the long term, education will get affected. Next slide, please. So coming to the conclusion, what we have found was, next slide, the psychopathology, when we had inquired, previous slide. So what we found was hopelessness was very high. I mean to say hopelessness was high among the male population, but again, anxiety was higher in the female population. So in that way, we had to do counseling, because sadness was found in the male, but anxiety was found in the female population. And we had done a lot of other follow-up counseling with this set of children, and it still is carrying on. It's not stopped yet, because counseling is continuing from June till now by this Monon initiative. And then next slide, please. And the intervention that we had taken for these children are different kind of interventions via the phone call. It is like we had given education to this kind of children, because they were at loss. They did not know about COVID. A lot of people had a lot of myths about COVID, and we had to do supportive work about relaxation, exercise, about sleep hygiene. And also there were a group of children who required no intervention because they were completely fine and doing well with COVID, because they did not think about the implications too much, but they are tense maybe because of the cognitive level in these children. So next slide. So we got a lot of kind of feedback about Monon initiative all over Assam, like 26% appreciated, 59% were satisfied. Next slide. And because of the counseling that we had, around 93% were stabilized, you know, via these telephones that we made individually to each and every COVID patients. Like around 60, 70 people were counseled by us. We're still continuously doing the, you know, the active counselors are doing counseling till now. Why have I actually included this data here today is just to give a picture that during this time, if COVID has impacted these children to this level, we do not know in the long term what is it going to happen, because we don't know the strand of this virus, how it is affecting, whom it is affecting, what is a neurocognitive domain on the implication due to COVID, which is definitely have to, we have to do a lot of research about that. And we have to take prevention and precautionary measures so that it doesn't get spilled over in our education and focus on our, you know, academics. So today, I think this is one good platform to talk about these different issues. And I believe the researchers have also brought in a lot of these domains in the four papers. I think they would, I really, I feel that that is there in the research papers. So let's hear what the various researchers has to say today, because girl child is one thing, but COVID as a whole, it's impacting the whole population, both male and the female child. Now with this words and the research that is going on in Assam, I would like to request the presenters. The first, I believe, is Mrs. Sumana Datta Sarkar, and she is the principal of Sachdeva Global School, Delhi, on analysis of the impact of COVID-19 online education and on the three learning domains of students. So let's see what she has to speak on this very important three main channels of learning domains. Over to you, Mrs. Sumana Datta Sarkar, please.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much. And I would, of course, first like to thank Bharti for this wonderful opportunity. It's a very, a session of various insights since morning, and something that Ms. Kadambari of Sambodhi was speaking in the morning stayed with me for the entire day. She said that as researchers and as educationists, we must be uncomfortable, and only if we are uncomfortable do we, you know, look for new solutions, and that is how the entire system evolves. So something big, something really that stayed on with me. Anyway, so as we are discussing the times of new normal, we've been in this very unique kind of an online education for the past almost 8 months now. And that has what has fueled this research, which is the impact of this online education on the three learning domains. Next slide, please. If we look at the uniqueness of the situation, the education has for the first time turned virtual for schools in India for all age groups and classes. Till now, it was mainly high school and university students. All stakeholders have been thrust into this mode without required technological development or expertise. More than 8 months into this, online assessments have also been conducted by urban schools. Parents are debating whether homeschool is a good, effective, safe, desirable alternative to regular classroom education. And of course, sadly, there seems to be no immediate cue of the situation coming to normal so that we can resume. Next question. So with that, the two research questions that guided this analysis were, does the current online education pattern impact all the three educational domains effectively enough? And should online education replace the regular schooling for all age groups of students? Next slide. Now, whatever literature we may look at, be it the first one, which mainly talks about the lack of connect and belongingness between the tutee and the taught, or between the taught, the students themselves, or the second one, which says that online tutoring has its own advantages with ease of documentation and analysis, or the third, which talks about the various risks to physical, mental, emotional, and social health of students. Next slide. Whatever be the literature that we've seen, all of them are limited in scope because they work firstly on the college and university level students. Secondly, this particular online education model of 2020 has no precedence because of the following features. That firstly, it is not as per choice, but mandatory. It is not self-paced, but follows a fixed schedule. Neither the learners nor the teachers have had any time for readiness in terms of mindset or technological know-how. Does not augment regular education, but replaces it. And of course, it is an unparalleled situation with no normal peer or social interactions or outdoor games or exercises. Next slide. So the hypothesis that I've worked on is that firstly, though the whole system seems to be seemingly very effective, seemingly in a continuum, the learning may be highly compromised in terms of levels and domains. And secondly, maybe the basic cognition levels are being assessed, but are we really assessing the higher cognition levels? Are we able to assess the effective and psychomotor domains? I've gone with the hypothesis that not really so. Next slide, please. So if we come to the methodology, it's been qualitative as well as quantitative with three main tools, comparative performance of students, a student questionnaire and a teacher questionnaire, of course, all in the virtual domain. Next slide. So the delimitations are that the sample is from private school students and teachers of Delhi studying under CBSE. Though the primary school teachers have been part of the sample, the primary school students have not been surveyed because of their, they may not be objective in answering questions. Online teaching and online assessments are the independent variables. Performance scores, extent of learning, satisfaction, happiness being the dependent variables. Going on to the first tool, next slide. The comparative performance of 2019 versus 20 of the midterm assessment of students of classes 8th and 12th in five different subjects. generally shows, as well as the aggregate percentage, generally shows that there's been a higher scoring in the online education followed by online assessment rather than the physical classroom education followed by physical assessment. Whether it shows a better learning or not is the question which we'll come back to later. Let's move on. Next slide. If we look at the student questionnaire, so the students, we've divided the students into two main categories, the middle school and the higher school, senior school, maybe because of their responses might be different. Next slide, please. So if we go on to the analysis, the understanding concepts through the online mode, establishing connect and happiness through happiness in studying through virtual mode, all these show high mean values, which might indicate that students have adjusted to this mode and are comfortable in continuing it. Next slide. As far as value of time in online mode, more opportunity. So value of time, 25% agreed that they have more value of time, 40% disagreed, rest do not seem to have ventured in using their time elsewhere. Opportunities to take on other interests because they're saving time. Online education saves commuting time. It saves time from getting physically exhausted. So more opportunities to take on other interests. 44% agreed, 33% have not ventured towards other things. Creativity, a clear 45% have agreed that their creativity has dwindled in the age of online education. Next slide, please. Absence of peer interaction on the ability to study happily, about 50 to 60% feel that they are unable to study happily because of their inability to interact with peers. Effect on skill learning, 55 to 60% of both segments have agreed that their skills and their hands-on learning is suffering. Absence of outdoor games on the ability to study happily, a staggering 90% agree that they're unhappy because of this, and that is in turn affecting their studies. Next slide. Whether they attempt online assessments honestly, 80% of the middle school level have agreed that they do, while a very poor 50% of senior students feel that they do it honestly. Relationship with parents and siblings, thankfully, this sample, only 9% feel that their relationship with the family members has deteriorated, while 50% feel that it has improved. Next slide. Existence of financial crisis does not seem to have bothered this sample under study because it is a private school sample from Delhi. Preference for homeschool in future, well, again, about 80% and more agree that they do not prefer homeschool for future. Next slide. If we look at the general inferences out of this, then we realize that the students seem to have developed a comfort level over the past 8 months. They miss their social and psychomotor development. They have low creativity and skill quotients. All of them may not have explored the extra time that they are getting effectively enough. Financial constraints, again, they have not really been much affected, but they all seem decided on their preference for regular physical school. Please move on. The second teacher's questionnaire, again, we've divided the responses into two, the primary school teachers and the secondary school teachers. Next slide, please. Whether the online education is mentally and emotionally healthy for students, 55% teachers do not agree. Connecting students with the concept and ascertaining whether the concepts are being followed, well, the teachers find it moderately easy by now. Next slide, please. Creativity of students, the primary school teachers feel that the creativity is high, but the secondary school feel that it is low. Self-motivation in students, again, primary school teachers feel that it is fine, while it seems to be ebbing in the senior school students. Efficacy of online assessments, both segments agree that the mode of assessment is not extremely effective compared to the physical classroom mode. Next slide, please. Student honesty, again, the primary school teachers feel that about 70 to 80% are honest in attempting their assessments. Senior school teachers have not shown much of agreement on this. Absence of peer learning and peer collaboration affecting student learning, more than 50% teachers agree that this effect exists and is negative. Observable changes in student behavior. Teachers have a mixed response to this. We'll come back that maybe the time that has elapsed is not enough. Next slide, please. Emotional connect with the students. 82% teachers feel that the emotional connect would have been far better in the physical school classroom environment than now. Online teaching, whether it is challenging, 40% feel that it is taxing and that this discomfort with online teaching may be affecting the children's learning. Well, again, the last question is a common question where educators, again, 75% of both segments have agreed that they will not recommend homeschool for the children. If we go on to the next slide, the analysis of this shows that teachers might have developed technological competency towards designing online teaching modules and teaching them effectively. However, some still find it taxing. The teacher-student connect is low. Absence of peer interaction is affecting children negatively. As far as motivation and creativity is concerned, the junior school teachers feel that it's high. It might be because of parent involvement, which may be absent in case of students in the senior school. Online education is not mentally healthy for students and they do not recommend it as a substitute is a common factor. Going on, if we now conclude on the various domains. So the first domain indicates that, so the physical classroom environment might be showing less scores, but it may not be a very true reflection because we know that the this online assessments can be inauthentic. In terms of the learning levels, knowledge, understanding, and application, we might be assessing them thoroughly, but whether we are analyzing the analysis, evaluation, and synthesis levels is not known. And the fact that lack of creativity exists may show that synthesis level is largely compromised. If we move on, affective domain, we may not have had time to ascertain this. However, lack of satisfaction and happiness in the tutee and taught may have far-reaching impact. And we also might observe a social isolation and a lack of interpersonal skills in the future if this model continues. If next slide, if we talk about the psychomotor domain, well, largely affected. Senior school students are learning only theoretical aspects of skill-based subjects. So virtual labs are unable to provide the skill or expertise of practical learning, and hence learning is incomplete and ineffective. Primary school students may be performing better in this domain under the guidance and motivation of parents, but this research has not taken on the effect of working parents, and hence we really can't comment on that. Next slide. So if we can conclude that this system is having a lot of learning gaps, which need bridging. And of course, it is also pointing towards the unquestionable value of school as a microcosm of society, where the entire all development, the holistic development takes place. And hence regular school, so the online or the homeschool can only supplement, regular school. It can only complement regular school. It cannot supplement it. Finally, the last slide, please. Recommendations would be that the age of the learner needs to be at a stage when he knows his interest areas and is self-motivated. There has to be, the module has to have connections built so that skill classes can be held, physical skill classes. Social interactions must be a part and parcel of the online system. We need to have a curriculum and evaluation which can assess all domains. So we really need to look into that. And of course, the technology has to be a partner. We need to have availability of technology, affordability of technology, and effective training to use it properly. Thank you so much. I'm sorry, I really spoke fast. So
thank you so much, Mrs. Sumana. So I actually am very interested. I was interested about the psychosocial domain of yours, and we have very less time for asking questions to you, I believe. But definitely, you had mentioned about the general intelligence is important, as well as social as an emotional intelligence, which are kind of contributory factors towards education. But the methodology and the sampling method and a lot of other stuff, I think, would have been, it was not very clear, the clarity in the research methodology, as far as I understand. I would like to ask you questions probably at the end of the four presenters, then it would be more interactive, I believe. What do you say, Mr. Antoni? Can I ask right now or?
We can keep the questions at the end because we have, let the other speakers also speak, and then you can start asking questions to them and we can throw it open to the other attendees as well. So request again the speakers to wind up in 5 to 6 minutes.
Yes, that is it. So I now request Mrs. Seema Gupta from Satya Bharti School, Jhaneri, to present her research study.
Thank you, ma'am. Jai Hind, everyone. I am Seema Gupta, founder teacher Satya Bharati, other senior secondary school, Chanedi, Sangrur. Am I audible, ma'am? Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, okay. Chanedi, Sangrur, Punjab, working as a coordinator, postgraduate in English and Hindi with master's in education, having a teaching experience of 15 years. This is my connect with the student and community that I have been traveling 100 kilometers daily from the last 10 years to reach the school by public transport. Next, please. The coronavirus pandemic, which originated in the city of Wuhan, China, quickly spread to various countries. No sooner did the coronavirus spread in India than our Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, announced the nationwide lockdown and everything came to a standstill. The education sector of India was the most affected one. Near about 32 crores students stopped going to school and colleges. But process of teaching and learning had to be done in a new way. All the school and colleges of the country adopted the virtual mode of education as an only possible alternate. This marked the commencement of the new era, the new normal. Next, please. The outbreak of COVID-19, next please. The outbreak of COVID-19 made us believe that change is inevitable. All schools and colleges were forced to opt online platform, which was never even thought to be relevant. So my research paper is based on the assumption that the new way of education has impacted young minds to think in a new and innovative way. It has proved to be a boom and opened a world of possibilities for students and teachers as well as parents. The present research paper focused on the following objective: to highlight various positive impact of COVID-19 on education, to explore pedagogical impact of new normal in education on teachers as well as children as well as parents. Next, please. For that purpose, next, please. For that purpose, I conducted a survey on social media platforms. A set of questions were asked to students, teachers, as well as parents by WhatsApp, Google Forms. So I selected a sample of 45 teachers, more than 400 students from classes 6 to 12. For the parents, teachers, and students are, next please. Are your parents supporting you during online classes?
Seema, just one
next
second.
Next slide, please.
Seema, I think your voice is breaking. Maybe the signal is an issue. So maybe you can switch off the video. Signal will be much better.
Okay, fine, sir.
Yeah, now it's better. Yeah, please carry on. Please carry on. Seema?
Seema, you're on mute, please unmute.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
am I audible? Yeah. So my research questions are your parents supporting you during online classes? Do you believe this lockdown made you resourceful and organized? Being a parent, are you also able to enhance your vocabulary? So these are the questions that I asked through parents, teachers, and students during on Google platforms. So next slide. Following points may be considered as the positive impact of COVID-19 on education. So next, please. From the survey conducted, it was found that about 60 to 70% of the students are comfortable with online classes. Next slide, please. As students found, online classes are more efficient as it not only saved their traveling time, but also expenses. It provided them flexible time schedule to help their parents in household work also. Next, please. Parents were also the significant part of this research. It was discussed that nearly 63% of the parents agreed that their vocabulary has enhanced due to online classes. Next, please. So there was a drastic change in the mindset of the parents in a sense that they now believe that a cell phone is a necessity, not a luxury. More than 3/4 of the parents were pleased about that, the fact that their child is able to pursue education amidst this pandemic. Next, please. Similarly, 60% of the teachers are in favor that virtual classes provide them with flexible time schedule. Next, please. Thus, teachers have adopted themselves to the new normal and thus recognized a significant alterations in their teaching process. Next, please. An outcome of virtual classes was that some of the parents learned that the vernacular phrase pahada is also called table. Next, please. Also, students were able to study weather forecasts, which helped them become better and efficient from managing. Next. So, coming to the conclusion, educational institutions move towards blended mode of learning and encourage all teachers and students to become more tech savvy. Yes. There are a number of students with limited or no internet access. Also, many students who can't afford laptops, computers, and cell phones. Online teaching learning may have created digital and such students, even if the COVID-19 crisis stretches longer, there is an urgent need to take efforts on maximum utilization of online platforms so that students not only complete their degree, but also to get ready for the first slides. So next slide. One of the key objectives was that it was discovered that more than 70% of students teachers
has 1 minute to conclude
new normal way of education and believe that this new normal make sure to enhance skill enhancement. Next, please. As teaching activities must be planned, so some of the key initiatives taken by government are to promote online education are e-pathshala, Diksha, Swayamprabha, and many more. Next, please. Teaching activities must be planned in such a manner that should not be one-sided, as many of the teachers asked in the Google form. Next, please. So, digital capabilities required infrastructure reach to the remote and rest communities to facilitate students to continue their education during this. So next, please. So these are some of the website. Some of the website I went through while preparing my research paper. That's all for my Jai Hind. Sorry, there was a network issue, I think.
Thank you, Seema. It was wonderful. We would definitely have an interaction after this. And I would now request Mrs. Astha Dhingra. She's a teacher and development coordinator and the director of education in Delhi. She's going to speak on online education, a tool or a barrier for the girl child. To you, Mrs. Astha Dhingra.
A very good afternoon to all the esteemed members of the session. Myself, Astha Dhingra, working as a TGT social science in a Delhi government school and also working in the capacity of teacher development coordinator of my own school. My heartfelt gratitude goes to Bharti Foundation for giving me this opportunity to present my mini research work on the topic of online education, a tool or a barrier for the girl child. Next slide, please. As a coin has two sides, as there is a good in everything bad, this deadly coronavirus also came up with new innovations, advents, and possibilities in the education field. As you can see on the screen, now school has come up to students' doorstep in a virtual manner. A new normal has begun with various new portals such as Diksha, Swayamprabha channels, websites, webinars, e-learning portals, and many more such things. Next slide, please. Based on my study of various reports and data, I have gathered various facts as to how online education is expected to grow exponentially in the coming years. But what is the state of girl education? Amongst these facts, only 35% internet users are women. So here comes a bitter pill to swallow. Here comes the issue of girl child and girl education. Next slide, please. So this gave birth to my research queries. My paper has tried to analyze various aspects of online education in terms of its current state, its merits, demerits, consequences, reasons, and repercussions. Next slide, please. The methodology I adopted consisted of close comparison of three sample case studies of school-going girls and boys in the light of a newly adopted online education mode. The three case studies were chosen from different socioeconomic backgrounds and across gender too. Next slide, please. After giving close thoughtfulness to case studies, I found that yes, online education has impacted the learners differently across different socioeconomic strata and also across gender. Next slide. I did a comparative analysis of my findings on the basis of various variables of online education. The three subjects I chose, three case studies, The students were Gia, Deepika, and Rajan. Let me give you a quick introduction to the subjects. Gia is an 11th grader belonging to a well-to-do family and goes to a renowned private school of Delhi. The girl has a personal device to attend and use online mode of instruction. Second subject is Deepika, who is a 10th grader. She belongs to a lower middle class family and studies in a Delhi government school, and she has five siblings. The family has only one device to cater to the needs of all five children, and there too, her brother is given preference to use the device. My third subject is Rajan, who is a boy of class 11th. Rajan, who studies in a government school, he owns a personal device, but is not able to attend the online classes as he is busy earning for his family during daytime. He is working as a painter in homes, and his family has went back to their hometown village. So I could interpret for Gia, online education has proved to be a tool, as she doesn't have to do any household work. She's highly satisfied for this home mode. Her parents can afford the online mode. She has the availability. But for Deepika, it is a different story. Rajan's interest in studies is also declining due to other priorities of his life. Next slide, please. My paper further throws detailed conclusion as to how online education is a tool for the girl child. Its various aspects are, it gives them a chance to continue their education. It improves the women's self-esteem by earning a degree. It gives them flexibility to learn at their own pace. There is no requirement to stay on campus to earn degrees. It makes women career oriented. It enhances their self-esteem. And most importantly, it empowers them. Next slide, please. But how is it a barrier? The barriers to online education for the girl child are as follows. They are because of the unequal reach. The pocket of the parents, the poverty factor is the biggest factor in a country like ours. The household work the girl child has to do, it hinders their personality development. And as we know, post-pandemic effects are surely there. Next slide, please. Summing up my inspections and introspections, I could conclude that there are three basic determinants which work in a process manner to evaluate the success of online education. The first one is affordability, that is the pocket of the parents. The second one is accessibility, that is the reach of the online mode to the students, and where once the medium of education are affordable and accessible, it gives flexibility to the women who can learn according to their own pace. So these are three important determinants for the online mode of education. Next slide, please. My recommendations: in order to make online education a success, we need to have a multilateral approach by strengthening technological infrastructure. We need to have a gendered approach in the issues of online education. Online education should aim at empowering women, and the barrier aspect can be transitioned by planned execution of government policy and by strategic planning and execution. Last but not the least, I would like to rephrase the paper title. Online education is definitely a tool for the girl child, but with a few barriers, which can be removed through strategic planning and execution. घरों को रोशन करने के लिए केवल चिराग काफी नहीं है, अंधेरे दूर बातियों के जलने से ही होते हैं. थैंक यू सो मच.
Thank you, staff, for a very lucid presentation.
Dr. Maitli, can you adjust the mic? Your voice is a little feeble.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
It's audible.
Am I okay now? Speak.
Yeah. Better.
Audible?
Yeah. It's better than earlier. It is better than earlier. Please go ahead. I think there is a signal issue.
So, but yeah. You can start.
Yeah.
I think you can just check my net connection.
Yeah. Thanks, ma'am.
I think Mr. Jahin Tuwal. Wait, pulsing.
Yadish. Jidesh, please share the PPT of Vedpal. Yes. Okay. Vedpal, please proceed.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes. Yes.
Thanks, ma'am. Jai Hind to all. I am Vedpal Singh, head teacher, Satya Bharati School, Barikhas. A big thank to Bharati Foundation and Convoke team for providing me such a great opportunity to present my research work here in this great event. Next slide, please. Friends, मैंने अपने research work में अपने आसपास के जो villages हैं उनको cover किया. इनमें मैंने reality of education and problems of girls in online education in online mode को कवर करने का प्रयास किया, और इसमें मैंने ये भी प्रयास किया है कि मैं कुछ सजेशंस या आइडियाज भी ढूंढ पाऊँ जिससे मैं इम्प्रूवमेंट कर पाऊँ, हम सभी इम्प्रूवमेंट कर पाएँ गर्ल्स एजुकेशंस को. नेक्स्ट प्लीज. सो फ्रेंड्स, मैंने जो क्वेश्चंस लिए हैं लिए थे अपनी रिसर्च के लिए, ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन गर्ल्स के लिए अपॉर्चुनिटी है या बैरियर है? यदि बैरियर है तो क्या और कौन कौन से ऐसे बैरियर्स हैं जिनको गर्ल्स सामना करती हैं अपने ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन में? साथियों, इसके साथ साथ मैंने यह भी जानने का प्रयास किया कि ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन और इन क्लास एजुकेशन में क्या डिफरेंट है. नेक्स्ट प्लीज. फ्रेंड्स, मैंने जो रिसर्च वर्क के लिए मेथोडोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल किया वो फील्ड सर्वे रहा, का सहारा लिया जिसमें लोगों से और गर्ल्स से फेस टू फेस बात की, वर्चुअली मोड पर बात की, और डिफरेंट जो ब्लॉग्स हैं, आर्टिकल्स हैं एंड रिसर्च ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन फॉर गर्ल्स को स्टडी किया. नेक्स्ट प्लीज. आफ्टर माय रिसर्च आई फाउंड दैट 143 फैमिली जिनको मैंने कवर किया था उनमें 93 गर्ल्स ऐसी थीं जो 6 से 16 या वर्ष के एज ग्रुप में आ रही थी. इन गर्ल्स में केवल 84% ऐसी गर्ल्स थीं जो स्टडी कर रही थीं, बल्कि इनको 100% वहां पर होना चाहिए था. फ्रेंड्स, इट वाज वेरी शॉकिंग टू मी कि केवल 29% फैमिलीज में ही एंड्रॉइड फोन था. यद्यपि अन्य सभी परिवार जो भी मैंने कवर किए थे सभी के पास बेसिक फोन्स थे. ड्यू टू क्लोजिंग ऑफ स्कूल ड्यू टू कोविड 19 गर्ल्स को हाउसहोल्ड वर्क्स में भी इन्वॉल्व होना पड़ता है, जैसा कि गर्ल्स के साथ बात करने में मैंने मुझे ये जानकारी मिली कि 56 गर्ल्स ने एक्सेप्ट भी किया कि वे हाउसहोल्ड वर्क्स में इन्वॉल्व होती हैं। इन्वॉल्व होने के साथ साथ फैमिली के जो अदर मेंबर्स हैं उनकी भी हेल्प करती हैं। इसके साथ साथ टेलीविजन की उपलब्धता भी रूरल एरियाज में काफ़ी कम है, और मैंने पाया कि ओनली 31 टेलीविजन इन 94 फैमिलीज। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। फाइंडिंग फ्रॉम अदर रिपोर्ट्स, फ्रेंड्स नीति आयोग ने भी अपनी रिपोर्ट में कहा है कि रूरल एरियाज में बहुत से ऐसे विलेज आज भी हैं जहाँ पर इंटरनेट के कनेक्टिविटी काफ़ी पुअर है, और केवल 28% परिवारों के पास ही इंटरनेट की उपलब्धता है। इसके साथ साथ यूनेस्को की ग्लोबल एजुकेशन मॉनिटरिंग रिपोर्ट भी कहती है कि लगभग 40% लो एंड लोअर मिडिल इनकम कंट्रीज हैव नॉट सपोर्टेड लर्नर एट रिस्क ऑफ एक्सक्लूजन ड्यूरिंग कोविड पेंडेमिक। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। आफ्टर माई रिसर्च माई कंक्लूजन्स ये रहे, यद्यपि 81% गरीब परिवार हैं, फिर भी ये लोग गर्ल्स एजुकेशन के लिए काफ़ी सिंसियर रहे, बट गरीबी और पेरेंट्स की मेंटालिटी की गर्ल्स शादी के बाद हाउस वाइफ के रूप में ही घर के काम करेंगी, इसके अलावा अन्य काम नहीं उनको करने पड़ेंगे। इसके कारण मेरी सर्वे रिपोर्ट में या रिसर्च में मैंने पाया कि 15% गर्ल्स ऐसी रहीं जो स्टडी नहीं कर रही थीं। और जितने भी मैंने फैमिलीज को कवर किया इनमें 11% ऐसे परिवार थे जिनका इंटरेस्ट एजुकेशन की तरफ से बहुत कम था। यद्यपि ये परिवार मिडिल इनकम से बिलोंग करते हैं, फिर भी जो है एंड्रॉयड फ़ोन या लैपटॉप बच्चों को मुहैया नहीं करा पा रहे हैं। साथ ही गर्ल्स के प्रति इनके एजुकेशन के प्रति इनका इंटरेस्ट भी काफ़ी कम है। यहाँ पर मैं ये भी कहना चाहूँगा, अपने टीचर्स से रिक्वेस्ट भी करना चाहूँगा कि जो गर्ल्स हाउस होल्ड वर्क्स में इन्वॉल्व होती हैं रूरल, खासतौर पर रूरल एरियाज में, तो उन गर्ल्स के टाइम शेड्यूल के अनुसार ही उन गर्ल्स को पढ़ाया जाए। टीचर्स को कन्वर्सेशन मोड पर विशेष तौर पे टीचर्स को ध्यान देना चाहिए, क्योंकि हमारे जो रूरल एरियाज में पुअर फैमिलीज हैं उनके पास बेसिक फ़ोन हैं, और 71% फैमिलीज ऐसी हैं जो बेसिक फ़ोन से कनेक्ट हैं, जैसा कि रिसर्च में मैंने देखा था। फ्रेंड्स मंथली फ़ोन रिचार्ज भी गरीब परिवारों के लिए, पुअर फैमिलीज के लिए एक बड़ा इश्यू है, और इस पर भी हम लोगों को फोकस करना चाहिए। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। आफ्टर द कंक्लूजन ऑफ माय रिसर्च, मेरी रिकमेंडेशन है कि मैं सभी टीचर्स और एजुकेशन से जुड़े हुए सभी लोगों से कहना चाहूँगा कि उन पेरेंट्स से अवश्य बात करें और उनको मोटिवेट करें, जिन परिवारों की, जिन फैमिलीज की गर्ल्स जो हैं स्कूल नहीं जाती हैं, स्टडी नहीं कर रही हैं, उनको मोटिवेट करना हमारा दायित्व तो है। साथ ही गांव में बच्चों को पढ़ाने के लिए लाउड स्पीकर एंड रेडियो ब्रॉडकास्ट का भी हमें सहारा लेना चाहिए। सफिशेंट एंड्रॉयड फोन ना होने की वजह से बेसिक फोन से कन्वर्सेशन मोड पर प्रोजेक्ट बेस्ड असाइनमेंट बच्चों को देना चाहिए, जिससे बच्चे आसानी से घर पर बेसिक फोन के माध्यम से भी सीख सकें, स्पेशली फॉर गर्ल्स। टीचर्स गांव में सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग के साथ ओपन क्लासेस को भी कंडक्ट कर सकते हैं, जिसमें वॉलेंटियर्स और मेंटरिंग प्रोसेस को इन्वॉल्व कर सकते हैं, मेंटर से भी सहायता ले सकते हैं, जैसा कि भारतीय फाउंडेशन में मेंटरिंग प्रोसेस जो है काफ़ी अच्छे ढंग से चल रहा है और रिजल्ट ओरिएंटेड भी है, और इसमें इन मेंटर्स का हम सहायता ले सकते हैं। साथियों लोकल लेवल पर विलेज सरपंच या एनजीओ इस रिगार्डिंग हम लोगों की सहायता कर सकते हैं, कॉमन स्टडी सेंटर चलाकर या उसको आईटी टूल के साथ इन्वॉल्व करके। इसके साथ साथ मैं यह जरूर कहना चाहूँगा कि ये संस्थाएं और गवर्नमेंट हैं, गवर्नमेंट्स स्टूडेंट्स को फ्री या सस्ता इंटरनेट डेटा पैक या रिचार्ज उपलब्ध कराएं, जिससे इन गरीब परिवारों के बच्चों की, गरीब परिवार की लड़कियों की स्टडी को कंटिन्यू किया जा सके। नेक्स्ट प्लीज। दिस इज माय बिब्लियोग्राफी ऑफ माय रिसर्च पेपर। सो थैंक यू। इन द लास्ट आई वांट टू थैंक अगेन टू भारती फाउंडेशन एंड कनबोक टीम। थैंक यू।
Yeah, thank you all the researchers. It was a wonderful presentation and a wonderful session. We have very less time, I guess. Though we have very less time, I just want to give some insight about all the papers. At this point of time, I just noted down a few things from the first researcher, Sumana Dr. Sarkar. What I have understood is that the subjective satisfaction that you told about and the joy are influential factors. And lack of those definitely leads to a downward curve that we all understand about the social and emotional dimension of intelligence, which are very, very important for a general academic performance as well as to cope up in life. I just wanted to know, you know, a little bit in detail about how the survey was conducted. So it was like not very clear your specific steps of collecting the research. I mean to say the samples, because I think you had written about 8 and 12 classes were taken. And the clarity was a little bit needed for this. Otherwise, the questionnaires were very appropriate and relevant. And there are a lot of implications and suggestions for future research on the basis of your research. What I understand is that I need to congratulate you because the social and the psychological domain are very, very important. I feel the implications, people can develop new research studies based on your findings in certain ways. Because as the keynote speaker had already spoken about attachment styles, the bonding, which are very important and which is lacking in online education. And I believe that you had brought out in your research paper. So I definitely would like to congratulate you, but the sampling and the random sampling, what method you have taken, a little bit more clarity in that is required for publication of your research paper, you know, for your future. And I'm just going to give a nutshell about all the four presenters at this point of time and would like to have your interaction after I present. Mrs. Seema Gupta, so I believe yours also, you know, the survey, how you have done with the, you said WhatsApp and other methods of taking. There are a lot of information in your study, a lot of information about the online basis, the government taking initiatives and so many other stuff. And definitely, but the specific aims and objectives of the study and how you had addressed that, a little bit more clarity in that. But there was an attempt to provide a very comprehensive research article. And it's a kind of an article and the knowledge can be shared in various domains. But what is one important factor that probably you could have focused on is the risk of exposure to inappropriate content. That is the online predators and other kind of abuse for the children. I mean, it's the exposure to different kind of inappropriate content in online education. I think that is one area that people need to look on while doing research in online education, because that exposure is huge and the kind of abuse or the kind of exposure has a deep impact on the children population. So how does spam messages and other stuff in the computer, which is I think an area which needs to be tapped more in detail. The other researcher, Mrs. Asta Dhingra. So what I understand, you have very well portrayed the online education as well as the merits and demerits, especially for girl child. And you had also depicted the online education platforms and the status in India, as far as I understood. But what I understand is from only 3 case studies, you know, and to talk about the various psychological and economical characteristics, only with 3 case studies, you cannot come to a conclusion. Because we have to again probably do some more research work, because these are 2-3 case studies, 2 girl children and 1 boy. I think the comparative between the gender also will be required with robust studies in this. And definitely a separate research design could be clubbed, because the baseline data a little bit from your studies can be taken. And we're very curious to know also about coming to arriving at all those findings with 3 case studies. So I think you need to write that as a limitation, you know, when you formulate and conclude. But definitely from here, we can take away the take home message could be that we give practical support to parents, caregivers, and specific protections to the vulnerable children, that is the girl children. But the conclusion has to be written with caution. And there is another study that you have done, Vekpal Singh. So it is basically a kind of an observational study and reflections that you have put across. There is no specific way how you have done the research work, because you said that you had visited the villages, you had spoken to people, whether you had spoken in groups, whether you had spoken individually or sent some, you said a blended method was taken face to face as well as online. So these are kind of, you know, when you publish certain such papers, these would be certain limitations. So you need to be very, very clear. So maybe it will color otherwise the variables and the coming to a conclusion to this. And then you had also mentioned about the structured questions being framed. So how you had framed the questions and what kind of methodology that you had taken, whether it is a narrative approach, like, you know, talking to people and gathering those information, because you mentioned in percentages, but we were not very clear about whether you had written any quantitative or structured methods of collecting data. You know, what questionnaires you have put across, those were not very clear, but definitely you may have missed in talking about those right now in the presentation, may have written in the paper, but I would suggest that you go a little bit more in detail about the data collection methods and how you have arrived at the conclusion, because this is something very vague, and in research you need to have some clarity in noting and expressing the facts. Overall, what I understand, all of the researchers have done very good job, because they have given insight about the domains of online education, a new normal and the gender variations in teaching and learning styles, and the challenges and strengths are also quite insightful. And girl child were always at risk for exploitation of various sorts. And I feel the girls have less access, as you mentioned, to digital technology than boys. That is something we need to take home, you know, as a message, that how this could be in the policy level, they can take up certain measures that, you know, how the mobile phone can be accessible to girls as well as boys. And I have seen a recent meta-analysis, and the prevalence and determinants of adolescent, you know, pregnancy part is also there, and a lot of other issues in you know, girl children that affects education. So all those different dimensions about how adolescent girls are being, you know, pushed to different kind of socio-cultural factors at this point of time, and how that may have an impact on the online education. If you've got certain other data of those kinds, probably we would also get certain lights, and people can do research work on those areas also. So we definitely have a lot of take-home messages from all these research papers, and I had a lot of difficulty actually to take out some areas which needs more input or improvement, but as a moderator, I thought that I should give you some insight about certain other stuff probably where you can improve upon your research work and for publication also. Thank you very much, and I would like some interaction and some questions, and if you could just give me some clarifications about certain things that I've asked. Thank you to all of you.
Thank
you, Dr. Hazarika. I'll just go into a bit of history why I got into this research, because as a principal, you know, when I look, very frankly, I expected the scores to dip. I expected it to be a worse performance this year. And when in the midterm, because till then, April, May was more or less, we were trying to, you know, get hold of the situation, understand what best platform, how to go about it. By July, we started, even May, we had taken one small assessment, which was a Google form assessment, but a proper pen paper test to be done and uploaded with an online virtual invigilation, all that we started in July. And when in September we went for the first, the midterm exams, I had expected the scores to dip. But on the other hand, in general, across the school and across, because it's not only just my school, it is also about, you know, we are part of something called as Sahodayas. So CBSE has these cluster Sahodayas. And when we discussed, every school seemed to be having the same kind of a pattern, that the scores for each child seems to have improved. Now, having said that, by the time we went into this exam, the invigilation was as much as possible, very, very strict invigilation, despite that, and the time frames and everything. So despite that, when this happened, my query to myself was, am I getting better? I mean, are the children learning this way better? I mean, could we do away with the school and they could sit at home and do it better? And that is what prompted this whole research. So the comparative analysis I have just taken of class 8th and 12th. I do have the entire data sheet of the rest, but just to present one slide here, class 8th, because it, I took a medium of, you know, 6th to 10th, class 8th, and class 12th, because it's a board class with some seriousness in mind. So, you know, for example, class 12th always performs better than class 11th, the same child in class 12th always performs better than in class 11th. So that is the same for class 10th versus class 9th. So these are certain variables where the study has not gone deep there, you know, and we cannot because of the different modes existing in the 2 years. As far as the questionnaires, both the questionnaires were thrown open to students of Delhi private schools, because again, it was thrown open to this cluster. So we have about 28 schools in Southwest Dwarka, which I am a member of. So it's a Sahodar. So this, and from there, I've taken out, samples. So say about, you know, a few students from every school and checked. So again, out of that, because I expected some questions to have different answers, very surprisingly, some did not have and some had. So I separated it into middle school and senior school, because senior school has a different kind of mindset. And thankfully, certain questions came out very honest answers. For example, honesty in attempting came out very honestly, that about 80-85% middle school students do attempt it honestly. And the seniors came out honestly that they do not. Despite all our methods, they have evolved methods to cheat. So that is how we know that the assessment that we are doing, the scores that we are getting are not really authentic. And of course, the one part that really troubles me badly is that everyone I asked is generally unhappy. There is a deep-seated unhappiness, which is with helplessness. So, you know, if you ask a child, the child will say, I'm unhappy to be sitting at home. There's nothing I can do about it. I understand, but I'm trying to study to my best. Now, what is the long-term implication of this? I do not know, but that is what troubles me. So the affective domain is something that's really troubling me. My teachers are not happy. My students are not happy. I'm not happy. It's a vacant school building that I come to every day. So somewhere inside, there's a state of helplessness, and especially Delhi, we don't know how long this will go on. I don't know whether I've answered all your questions. You tell me, Dr. Hazare.
Yeah, I think so, because, you know, the methodology part, as you know, in publication that we require later on, probably the sampling, the random sampling and all. So yeah, you fairly answered the question well, and also the affective domain, as I said, is very, very important, and you've brought across this in your research work. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Are there any other speakers who would like to respond? Asta, Seema, and Vedpal.
Yes, sir, I would like to answer, ma'am.
Yeah.
As ma'am has asked that I have taken up only 3 case studies. Ma'am, this is not the case, actually. I am a teacher myself, and the second case study, Deepika, is one of my student only. So she was a representative of the whole strata. I could not put in too many case studies in the research paper. She was a representative only. I have came across around 30 to 40 girls like this, very heartfelt stories they have got for this online mode of education. They are helpless right now. They want to study, but they are not able to. A girl is there alone in the house with her father. The mother is in the village. She's helpless. She's a good student, but no device. Ma'am, I can't attend the online classes. And for the good socioeconomic background, as I've taken up Gia, the case study of that, she's my niece.
So it was like an introspection and was like a gist of all the different type of students I have got to meet. So I took up one representative from each of the strata. And for the third case study, I came across this boy Rajan. Ma'am, we got our home painted last month when this convo was going on, and I was thinking about this research methodology and that what path I would take to do this. And I came across him. He was the helper of my painter. And I was feeling guilty also. I am a teacher in the school and at home, I am making this boy. I was just counseling him, ki beta, aap ye chhod do, aap apni class attend kar lo, please. Please leave this. Aap ye helper wala kaam mat karo. And he used to say, no, ma'am, main raat ko karta hun wo. Ek do ghante raat ko pad leta hun, but I think I will be a dropout and I will leave the study and I'm a full-time painter hi ban jaunga. So this was a reality check for me ki this is the hard truth, the priorities of life with what a 17-year-old boy is facing right now. He has to support his family and he has nothing to do but to help and do odd jobs for earning. Whereas he wants to study, he wants to earn. I asked him, what is your aspiration? What do you want to do? And he say, main to IAS karna chahta hun, par ma'am karte kaise hai, mujhe kuch pata hi nahi. I don't know what to do. So it was really this research paper. I took it up as a challenge to myself, but it had some insights for me also as a humane for the effective zone of our learning also, that we should also do something. We should also come forward as teachers, as stakeholders of the society to help such students. So that's all from my side. Thank you.
And very true. You know, what is reflected is that you have done a case series kind of a study, right? So that should have been reflected. And that's a very wonderful way of doing it. Like you can do all those cases and see the pattern and that you must have done that and kind of concluded according to different
rules,
right? And the assent and the consent is also important, ethical concerns and all. And writing the names of the students, whether they are real names and not to name the students, those are also different concerns while writing the paper. So I think this is, I said already, could be a base for some other studies and club together. And I think implication is definitely there. And to do what after this? It's all depends upon the policymakers again. Yeah, thank you. It was a very good insight.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Ma'am, Vedpal Singh.
Yes.
कुछ बोलना चाहूँगा मैम. मैम, मैंने जो अपनी रिसर्च की थी वो मैं आसपास के जो गांव में हैं जहाँ पर मैं रहता हूँ वहाँ के तीन गांव मैंने कवर किए. तो उनमें जो है कई बार मुझे फ़ोन नंबर मिल गए, पेरेंट्स से बात हो गई, बच्चियों के फ़ोन नंबर्स मिल गए तो उनसे बात हो गई. उसके साथ साथ पेरेंट्स के गांव में भी इन गांव में मैं विजिट किया लेकिन सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग के साथ विजिट किया. वहां पर मीटिंग्स सिंगल सिंगल पेरेंट्स से बात हुई, मीटिंग्स को नहीं लिया. तो वहां पर ये सारा डाटा मैंने कलेक्ट किया और वास्तव में सिचुएशन मैम जो रूरल एरिया है वहां पर काफ़ी ज़्यादा पुअर है ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन की. इसके लिए हम सबको मिलकर एक प्रयास अवश्य करना चाहिए कि बेसिक फ़ोन तो ऑलमोस्ट सभी फैमिलीज में हैं इस समय. तो हम जितने भी टीचर हैं या हमें सुन रहे हैं आज, तो ये सभी टीचर्स को बेसिक फ़ोन पे कुछ इनोवेटिव करना चाहिए कि क्या हो सकता है. जैसे असाइनमेंट बच्चों को देना है उसके बारे में, उसके बाद बात करना है, प्रोजेक्ट वर्क देना है उसके बाद में उसको बात करना. मेंटोरिंग प्रोसेस की मैं भी बात कर रहा था, तो मेंटोरिंग प्रोसेस जैसा कि भारतीय फाउंडेशन में अच्छे ढंग से चल रहा है और काफ़ी रिजल्ट ओरिएंटेड भी है, तो ये काफ़ी चीज़ें जो है हमको हेल्प कर सकती हैं इन रूरल एरियाज में गाँव की गर्ल्स के लिए. ये ओबियसली है कि गांव में जब बच्चियां घर पे रहती हैं तो उनको घर पे थोड़ा बहुत काम तो करना ही पड़ेगा, करना ही होता है, हम सभी को करना होता है. लेकिन उन बच्चियों के टाइम स्लॉट के अनुसार ही हम लोगों को काम करना पढ़ाना चाहिए, क्लासेस लेनी चाहिए, ना कि अपने टाइम स्लॉट के अनुसार. थैंक यू मैम.
थैंक यू. Yeah, you had given an insight about the villages, जैसे कि आपने गांव में जाके आपने रिसर्च डेटा कलेक्ट किया, मगर कैसे किया, what is the structure methodology, you know, those were important, जैसे कि questionnaires method, और इज इट इन अ ग्रुप, सब लोगों के साथ एक साथ बैठ के आपने कलेक्ट किया जैसे कि डिस्कशन मोड में, सो दैट इज फाइन. You have given a very good picture about the villages and all. I think people need to take up all the suggestions that you have given in the villages. And it's a good work.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Excuse me, ma'am. I'm here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you are.
I want to say something, ma'am.
Yes.
So from last, I was Satya Bharti School. So from first of the April, we are providing online education. So it has been almost 8 to 9 months since we have been in person. Your virtual mode. So actually I want to know, this is my first research paper. Actually I wanted to know whether all that in the education worth the while or not. So by conducting this research, I could get at a good insight about how well my efforts are being paid off. Most of the students are from underprivileged background. So that's why I wanted to know that these students are actually getting benefit or not. So that's why I put my research on that paper.
Yeah, very nice. I just wanted to know, you had mentioned how much percentage had wanted post-COVID to continue online education. You mentioned 70% or something like that. What is it, the percentage that had said that they would like to continue or they are benefited by online education? That was not very clear.
Yeah, they are like,
yeah.
Okay.
So that was a recent question.
Ma'am, research questions. Yes, ma'am.
So, but that question was not addressed. So that is what was my query. If you can go back and see if, what is your take on that? If 70% of the people wants to continue post-COVID online education. So as a teacher, what would be your take then?
Actually, some of the teachers, parents and students are very happy with this online education, but some of the teachers are not that much good. So I have recommended that there should be two-sided activities, that we should include children activities so that it can be two-sided. So that's why I have written post-COVID analysis on that.
Yeah. No, that was a good attempt. This is your first research paper. I think you've done quite a lot of elaborated, articles and research and some bibliography. You've done a lot of reference and all also about what is the digital modes that the government of India had taken up and all. So I think you can write two research papers from here. From whatever you have analyzed and the findings, you can make two studies and present separately, as a research article of the other domain. That what government of India is doing and your own findings separately. So that becomes two. That makes a lot of sense in presenting the data when you do it. Because your research questions and also about the online education the government is doing is not telling in this paper. So you can make two studies and present it and go for publication, I believe. But it was a good attempt as a first-time researcher, and all the best for your future, endeavors. And thank you all. I got enriched by a lot of things because from my domain, I'm from the health domain. And now I'm in the National Education Plan of Assam as a core committee. So we are framing a lot of things for girl-child education. And this has really helped me and the platform has really helped me. I should thank Mr. Anthony because this is going to go into my state of Assam's plan in National Education Plan that we're working on girl children also. And thank you very much, all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Maitli, for moderating such a good session, and also happy to, this is completely from an academic twist that you have given to the whole, in encouraging the speakers to get into publication, and that is one of the, way forward that we are looking at in Bharati Foundation, how we can gradually get into journal, so that the teachers who are coming in the forum, how they can be guided and help them into get into journal publication. It's finally the teacher's voice needs to be there, out there. Of course, there are a lot of policymakers, a lot of academicians are there, but if the real voice of teachers and students are not there, then the education in itself, there is something missing. So thank you to one and all the speakers. Congratulations for such a beautiful presentations. And thank you, Dr. Maitli, for the moderating the sessions. So as a token of appreciation, we'll be sending you a certificate, planting a tree in your name somewhere in some of the rural areas. So that's one way of appreciating your efforts. And I can see that there are three people who have raised the hand: Pooja Sharma, Trivedi, Meenu Bala, and Renu Bala. If you can type in the questions in the chat, we will be able to do. We are already 15 to 20 minutes extended the session, but I understand this is the last session, and we have Seda ma'am having one ode to the teacher, a poem that she would like to read out. So ma'am, then we can just read out as a real as a good tribute to all our teachers out there doing the various job. So maybe you'd like to read, and then we can conclude that there is no talk after that. You're on mute, ma'am. Ma'am, please unmute
yourself. I would love to do that, except I don't take any precious time away from these precious people. I feel rotten about that. I basically am saying that this is a child speaking to a teacher. I think it's a great inspiration.
Yes,
it says, I remember the first day how I looked down, hoping you wouldn't see me. And when I glanced up, I saw your smile shining like a soft light from deep inside you. I think it's important. I'm listening, you said. Come on, just join my conversation. Let us hear your near uncertainties, thorny doubts, tangled angers. But for weeks, I had inside, I read and reread your notes, praising my writing, and you whispered, we need you and your stories and questions that like a fresh path will take us to new vistas. Slowly, your faith grew into my courage. And for you, instead of handing you a note or apple or flowers, I raised my hand. I carry your smile and your faith inside, like I carry my dog's face, my sister's laugh, creamy melodies, the softness of sunrise, steady blessings of stars, autumn smells of gingerbread, the security of a sweater on a chilly day. This is what teacher means to a child.
Yeah.
It's a difference in life. So congratulations, everybody who is a teacher and who is helping teachers. I mean, not every one of you is actually a pedagogue, but everybody is making this a great activity, which it is. So thank you very much for including me. This has been Revelations, extremely blessing. It's a blessing. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for ending. Like, it's a fitting ending, I would say, where we are dedicating this whole convo for teachers and the principals, the grassroots, the people who are really making education a difference in our country. And thank you once again to you for gracing this occasion as a keynote speaker, Dr. Maitli, once again as a moderator. And I would like to announce that tomorrow, this is the end of today's session. And I'm sure all the participants would have also picked up a lot of learnings. And this is a very good occasion for all our teachers who are coming, who have joined us from, whether it is from government school or from our Satya Bharti school, or even from B.Ed. college students who have joined us in listening to some of the great people on board who has given us a keynote speaker and as a moderator, and also listening to some of the first time researchers, or some of them I have done also sometime research in the past. Tomorrow we are starting the session at 10 o'clock. And the session is on use of research and technology to achieve school excellence. So we have Mr. Rajnish Kumar, Director of Digital Education, Department of School Education, Literacy, Ministry of Education, coming as a keynote speaker. We have Dr. Vimla Ramachandran as its moderator. And we have five good papers coming up from our teachers and also mentor teachers of Delhi and the principals of some of the schools. So once again, thank you to all the participants who have joined us. While you are signing off, you will be asked to do a kind of a exit survey. Please fill it up so that we will know how much of the learnings also has been part of it. Tomorrow, please understand that we are going to have a final quiz at the end of session, morning session. So that will give us an idea who are the leaderboards, who are the, you know, the key participants, keen participants, and those who are alert. So I'm sure most of these information will be also alive on Facebook Live. So those of you who want to revise all the lectures that has been given by the keynote speakers, moderators, and all the speakers, most welcome to revise all the points. There are a lot of going to be some questions, and let's see who gets top five. Thank you once again for joining in. Wish you all the best. Take care. Stay safe. Bye-bye.
Anthony, may I just make a few home rules?
Yeah, please go ahead.
All right. Hi, everybody. This is Sameen here from Team Convoke. I just wanted to remind everybody, especially the audience, please register for tomorrow. The link that you had, just use the same link and choose 26th as a date, and please register for tomorrow so that you don't have any issues in the morning. Panelists, you can use the same links so that you can see the session tomorrow as well. And thank you very much. Great job done, everybody.
Okay, bye-bye. Take care. Stay safe. And I'm sure you can go have a wonderful rest after such a learning environment. Bye-bye.